Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm David Josephson. I've been asked to make a few remarks about the symphony we'll be hearing tonight, and it's my honor to do so. The talk is simply entitled Beethoven's Ninth. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of joy. Of course not. The pursuit of happiness was Thomas Jefferson's phrase. By the way, he wrote inalienable in his manuscript. Someone changed it on the way to the printer to conform to the then standard, unalienable. Jefferson found that phrase in John Locke, who wrote in his essay concerning human understanding in 1693 that, quote, the highest perfection of intellectual nature lies in a careful and constant pursuit of true and solid happiness, which is the foundation of liberty, end quote. Since it frees us from our selfishness, it transcends our baser desires. That same elevated state was what Isaac Watts had in mind when, in 1725, he used Locke's phrase, defining happiness as, quote, the attainment of the highest and most lasting natural good, end quote. And it was what Samuel Johnson had in mind 30 years later when, using Locke's phrase as his model, he defined happiness in his Dictionary of the English Language as, quote, the state in which we attain the highest degree of all our perfection. And then Johnson quoted the line, we happiness pursue, to support the definition in his dictionary of the word pursuit. Johnson's dictionary had no entry for joy. The word seems to have been used less commonly than happiness during the Enlightenment. When it was used, it usually connoted cheer, merriment, a transient pleasure. So it is usually found in phrases such as mirth and joy, or jump for joy. That was Boswell's phrase. The distinction, while not absolute, Wordsworth, for one, found a higher impulse in the word joy, was clearly present nonetheless. For Jefferson, the pursuit of happiness yielded liberty not only from our baser instincts, but also from the tyranny of unwanted rulers. That same pursuit of happiness gripped the fiery young German poet and playwright Friedrich Schiller, a central figure of the German Enlightenment, who was inspired by the young American Republic. Barely a decade after the Declaration of Independence, Schiller published the poem An die Freude, the poem we English speakers know as the Ode to Joy. Now, common translations into English for the German word Freude are joy, pleasure, delight, happiness. And common translations into German for the English word happiness include die Freude. Yet we never read of the ode to pleasure, or the ode to delight, or the ode to happiness. The ode to joy has stuck. But we would do well to consider that the elevated state of happiness, as Locke and Jefferson understood it, what Schiller was after when he wrote the poem. For that poem is an ode to a utopia where enlightened and newly free men become brothers in a nobility of merit under the dominion of a benevolent father. It is not an ode to mirth. Schiller was not a man who jumped for joy. Neither was Beethoven. They had loftier pleasures in mind. An die Freude swept across Europe just as the Declaration of Independence had done. And it quickly reached the Enlightenment circle in Bonn, in which the idealistic young Beethoven came of age. He was 15 years old when the poem was published. That poem spoke directly to him. for he held as an ethical necessity the need, his words, to do good, to love liberty, to never deny truth, to love virtue, to love everything good and beautiful. Beethoven soon began to mine Schiller's poem. 4 years after its publication, in 1790, he quoted passages from it in a composition that honored an enlightened ruler. 2 years after that, he proposed setting Schiller's entire poem, and a friend told Schiller that the setting would be an excellent one, for Beethoven was, in his words, wholly devoted to the great and the sublime. Beethoven returned to An die Freude several times in his musical sketches over the next 20 years. When a complete set of Schiller's works appeared in 1824, he acquired it, all 21 volumes of it. It was in that very year, coincidentally, that he composed the last movement of his last symphony. And there he finally found the right place for Schiller's poem, or at least for a version of it that scraped off every word that did not adhere to the message that Beethoven wanted to convey, namely, a paean to freedom and brotherhood under God, an ode to happiness, carefully pursued, and finally, after monumental struggle, achieved. And a monumental struggle it was. Beethoven composed the Ninth after abandoning symphony as a genre for a decade. And his decision to bring words into it at the end, words that make explicit the implicit meaning of the music that precedes them, cost him endless sketching. Like other music of his last years, it is radically personal, unstable, searching. It uses the full resources of its large orchestra, as no composer had ever used an orchestra, and it makes unprecedented demands on the instrumentalists. Early performances ranged from the ragged to the incoherent. So challenging are the demands that rare is the conductor who does not tinker with what Beethoven wrote, simplifying it here, improving it there. Richard Wagner did it. Gustav Mahler did it, Leonard Bernstein did it. The solo singers in the first performance in May 1824 found their parts unsingable. Those parts have gotten no easier in the intervening 188 years. This symphony is a monster. Struggling scales, vast leaps, shadowy premonitions, and touching reminiscences haunt every movement. At times, the music assaults our ears. Listen to the violent climax in the first movement with its furious timpani rolls and to the savage fanfares that open the last movement. There is rapt beauty as well, notably in the introspective third movement and in passages in the final movement that set Schiller's references to God, to the Creator, to a loving Father who dwells above a canvas, a tent of stars. After its first performance in Providence in 1868, our local critic had this to write about it. I found the orchestra part very tiring. Several times I had difficulty staying awake. It was a relief when the choral part arrived. It opened with 8 bars of a theme like Yankee Doodle. I regret to say that this part of the symphony appeared to be made up of the strange, the ludicrous, the abrupt, the ferocious, the screechy, with the slightest dash here and there of an intelligible melody. Following the words printed in the program was out of the question. It was hard to form any idea what all the noise was about. The general impression it left is that of Indian war whoops and angry wildcats. Our Providence critic's question, what was the noise all about, has consumed over 20 books and hundreds of articles. The subject of this symphony is inexhaustible. So let me focus tonight on just one magnificent detail, the opening gestures of each of the four movements. For each shows Beethoven at his most fastidious as it prepares the ground for the musical argument to follow, establishing tempo, meter, key, and, most important, the tone of address, the tone of voice of what follows. Each opening gesture makes its statement so succinctly and integrates itself into the body of music so seamlessly that unless you listen carefully, you don't quite catch its sublime purpose. Following the model of his teacher Haydn, Beethoven had opened four earlier symphonies with grand formal curtain raisers that relate theatrically but not thematically to the music that they introduce. But following no one's model, he opened two other symphonies with brief gestures that do prepare what follows. He opened one symphony with a pair of pistol shots. Beethoven also introduced the final movements of five earlier symphonies, but only now. Computers and I don't always get along. But only now in the ninth did he go to the trouble of introducing the argument of every movement in the symphony. And trouble it was. It took him 18 different stages of sketching, for instance, just to get the noble melody of the last movement, the Ode to Happiness, right. That melody, which Beethoven meant to be popular, may sound spontaneous, but it was nothing of the sort. Let me now take you through the introductions. The ninth opens with a patient, inexorable murmuring of two sustained pitches, a hollow fifth apart. Music so quiet that it is as if we had entered the symphony after it had begun, through which fragments of two notes, then three, then more, descend in an accelerating rhythm, foreshadowing what is to come. Here is the introduction. The music takes form even as we listen to it, gathering its energy and coalescing into the mighty main theme of the movement. Now we'll hear the introduction again and what it introduces. The second movement is introduced by a savage three-note rhythm, yamparam, that forms the core rhythm that drives that movement. You'll hear the rhythm four times in eight measures. One element that contributes to the savagery is the octave leap down from the first note to the second and then the third. Another is the striking use of timpani for the third statement of the rhythm. Bum-ba-dum, bum-ba-dum, dun-dun-dun-dun-dun. Finally, there is the unsettling phrasing. A bar of music, a bar of silence. A bar of music, a bar of silence. Two bars of music, two bars of silence. This music gnarls at us before launching into its relentless, magnificent subject, banishing those silences for good. The third movement, a set of variations on two themes, is introduced by the gentle piling of four bereft bassoons and clarinets, one upon another, supported by distant strings. It introduces the first of the two themes, a sublime melody. Schiller, by the way, wrote two essays on the sublime. A sublime melody sung by the strings in three phrases, each phrase echoed affectionately by warm woodwinds and horns. Second phrase. With its echo. I took these examples, by the way, from a recording with which I have lived for the 50 years since it was produced, and which is dear to my heart, George Zell's performance with the Cleveland Orchestra, recorded in Cleveland in Severance Hall in 1961. Now for the startling outburst that opens the final movement. Whatever else it might be, this movement is not an introduction. It does not prepare us, as the others do, for what follows. It does not set the mood for the music to come. What it does is annihilate everything that has preceded it. This noise is cut off abruptly to yield to a passage of wordless recitation by the cellos and basses. Intertwined in this wordless recitation as it follows is a review and then a dismissal of each of the first three movements, allowing the famous melody eventually to emerge. Beethoven's sketches here are fascinating. His first version of those dismissals, the dismissals of the first three movements, was not wordless at all, but explicitly verbal. After quoting music from the first movement, he wrote in his manuscript, "Oh no, not this. I require something more agreeable." After the quotation of music from the second movement, he wrote, "Not this one either. It's no better, just a little more cheerful." After the quotation from the third movement's music, he wrote, "This one is too delicate. I must find something livelier. I myself will sing you something in tune with the mood." And here he writes down the first two measures of the famous ode, and then he writes above it in German, "This is it. We have found it." None of those words made it into the final version of the symphony, of course, but Beethoven's identification of himself with his music would in the end find more terse verbal expression. At last, that famous melody arrives. The orchestra sings it four times, each time in a variation of increasing elaboration. Here it is, just in case you've forgotten it, along with the beginning of the first variation. A fascinating melody in three phrases. Two phrases. The second one is repeated to make a third phrase. Second phrase. Second phrase repeated. It goes on for three variations. Then, unable to continue, the melody breaks off. That savage opening outburst that we heard returns, again followed by recitation, but this time with a decisive difference. For now, Beethoven gives words to the wordless recitation. His own words, sung in his own voice, not Schiller's. "Oh, friends, not these notes. Instead, let us give voice to notes more pleasant, more filled with happiness." And now at last, he sings the famous melody to words that open Schiller's poem, "Happiness, beautiful spark of the gods." Eventually, he introduces us to a second foundational theme, this one of overwhelming eloquence to Schiller's words, "Be embraced, you millions, this kiss to the entire world, brothers, a loving father must dwell above the canvas of stars."
Sight from heaven,
shoulders. Be embraced. You millions. This kiss. Above the canvas of stars, must a loving Father dwell. Two great themes as his subject, both of them Jeffersonian in their nobility, Beethoven will lead us in an epic undertaking, moving through utterances alternately monumental, martial, and intimate, through vast fugues, through heartbreaking vocal quartets, unsingable vocal quartets, and triumphant choral affirmations, all of them circling back on themselves with increasing intensity, again and again, until after one last iteration of the opening words, the music explodes in a headlong dash. Beethoven wrote, as swiftly as possible, to its appointed end. Happiness pursued, happiness achieved. Thank you.